today, in the world, there are about 6,000 languages, small or big. It's sad to hear that in about next century or so, 100 years' time, half of these languages will be wiped out from the surface of the earth. That is, 3,000 of these languages will die in 100 years. Statistically speaking, this means every 2 weeks, one language dies. This is very sad, and this is the downside of language. But the thing is, can we do anything, or should we blame imperialism or the big powers for eliminating these languages from the surface of the earth? Well, if one is an extremist, one would say, yes, it's the imperialism that has to be blamed. But on the whole, there are languages with one or two speakers only left. So if they die, the language dies with them. Probably not everything can be blamed on the imperialist. What governments can do, they can, as some governments have done in the world, they can put in some money to revive some of these languages, at least in terms of documentation. But let's look at the picture a bit historically, then diachronically. In the European languages, there are Celtic languages or Celtic languages, like Irish, Welsh, and Scottish. These people did not speak English at the beginning, but they are reduced now, a kind of reductionist, if you like, approach. They have been reduced to using English now. And probably using Welsh or Scottish or, say, Irish is not more than a curiosity in most places in the English territory. As a second language example, one can cite Swedish for the Finnish. In Finland, Swedish was used to be spoken as a second language, but nowadays, not only Finnish, but also Swedish have come under the umbrella of English. That is, they are dominated by the English. French, which was a colonizing language, today is colonized by English. So once we had this term, francization, that is, they were going to make everyone speak French, or Germanization during the World War. But nowadays, among European languages, including Germanic or German and Romance languages like French or Spanish, they have becoming under the umbrella of English. So this is the picture in Europe, and in the rest part of the world is not a better one. I'll go to that a little bit later. But diachronically speaking, the sad thing is that, again, within one's community, one's country, one's society, you also see this discrimination. That is, language as a discriminatory power. Take wealthy people and poor people. The wealthy people send their children to good school, private schools. They get good education, good practices. They become good writers, probably good readers. And the poor ones are deprived of this. So within one community also, there is this linguistic imperialism, which drags us to the definition of linguistic imperialism or language imperialism. I like to quote this from one of the Western linguist, Philipson, who is critical of linguistic imperialism. He says, linguistic imperialism involves the transfer of a dominant language to other peoples. The transfer is essentially a dominant of power. It doesn't work. I'm sorry, I have to adjust this. Anyway, it involves the transfer of a dominant language to other people. The transfer is essentially a demonstration of power, traditionally military power, but also in modern world, economic power, an aspect of dominant culture are usually transferred along with the language. Philipson, a widely quoted scholar in the field, proposes that proposes the theory that critiques the historic period spread of English as an international language, and that language continued dominance, particularly in post-colonial settings such as India, Pakistan, and Zimbabwe, Uganda, and many other places. It is also increasing in neo-colonial settings such as continental Europe. The arguments that are put forth by these critiques are that one is intrinsic arguments, which describe the English language as providential, rich, noble, and interesting. Such arguments tend to assert what English is and what other languages are not. Extrinsic arguments point out that English is well established. That is, it has many speakers and that there are trained teachers and a wealth of teaching materials. So this indicates that if you want to choose another international language, you have to start from the scratch and you have to provide all these things. So English is there, everything taken is to granted. Therefore, let's live with English and take it as it is, but maybe we can do something about it to suit our cultures. Functional arguments emphasize the usefulness of English as a gateway to the world because today, majority of findings and scientific achievements are done in mostly, let's say, English territories, English-speaking territories. Other arguments for English are the economic utility. It enables people to operate technology, its ideological function, it stands for modernity, and it stands as a symbol for material advance and efficiency. This is what those people claim to say, we have to keep English. Now, the question is, do we need any international language? If yes, we have to keep in mind that acquiring English is today at least something difficult to avoid. And it is impossible to learn a foreign language without being influenced ideologically, politically, culturally, etc. So if when you learn a language, this is the basic tenet of language learning, that like it or not, you learn part of that culture. But can you avoid it? We will see. If you learn a language and you are influenced so much by the culture, then a global culture will emerge wherein cultural artifacts are being created, say in this situation, in today's situation, English language by non-native speakers. When a practitioner explains to a student that one variety of language is superior to others, say, take our Persian case, if you teach to your students that there is a standard Persian, there are other minor languages, or with 5 minutes left, so I have to rush to. We are. If you talk about other languages being of minor value, then you are marginalizing those languages, and you are making an imperialistic view yourself as a teacher. I have to skip so many. Other things, but this is important. The situation is not true with English. In other parts of the world, you have a similar situation. In Far East, in Africa, in South America, there are regional languages that are being replaced by bigger and dominant languages. Tibetan and Marathi Chinese dialect by Mandarin Chinese, Quechua by Spanish. In Spain, there are so many languages, and Spanish is dominating. So it's not only particular to Anglo-American culture, it's all over the world. In today's India, English exists side by side with the Hindi language, and they have accepted to be used in their school system. The critique is that Alan Davis, on one side, argues that Philipson claims are not falsifiable. What if the dominated wanted to adopt English and continue to want to keep it? That is, we accepted it, we wanted to continue with that, so you cannot blame the language or the owners of the language. As today you can see, they give this example, if you want to make demonstration in Italy, in other parts of the world, you have to raise a flag wherein the symbols are written in English to show that you're doing something against the government. Those who support the argument favoring the reality of linguistic imperialism claim that arguments against it are often advanced by monolingual native speakers of English who may seek the current status of English as a fact worthy of celebration. Some who reject the concept of linguistic imperialism argue that global spread of English is better understood in the framework of approbation. That is, English is used around the world for local purposes. In addition to the example of Nigeria, which I missed it, other examples can be given. Due to short of time, I have to skip this one. And come to solution. Now, is there a solution? It seems so. A multiplicity of teaching practices and a view of language as belonging to a broad range of peoples and culture is the best that language instructors can do in institutionalized teaching and learning setting to promote cultural equality. What happens outside this institutional hall, the exposure which students have to other input, which is also an aspect of linguistic imperialism, is beyond the language instructor's control. Say today, almost everyone is exposed to satellites, and almost everywhere people listen and watch TV programs in English, and they are developing English. At the same time, they are absorbing some of the culture. Without discrediting the spread of any language, one is forced to accept the fact that international movement requires a language for wider communication. It is also the case that there is a need to support minority languages and cultures. Thus, one can say the globalization movement is attempting a risky balancing act. While on the one hand there is a call for a language of wider communication, we have on the other hand a sincere desire to preserve cultural diversity. These two movements, which are contradictory, are bound to result in conflict and irresolution. Kachru, one of the Indian scholars in the United States, proposes that one way to safeguard the cultural integrity of non-native speaker is to promote those indigenized varieties of English, which are established form of international communication. So this means that we have accepted English as the dominant language, so let's embrace it, but at the same time tame it in order to suit our culture. Another remedy would be the promotion of a multitude of international tongues. This can be put into question whether that is a possibility, and dilute the impact with which Anglo-American forces have on the non-native speakers' cultural and linguistic integrity. Of course, there have been governments around the world, like in New Zealand, for instance, there are Maori people which have been given the chance to open up their schools, and even you can have education in Maori at university level. In Australia, for instance, there have been among democratic countries, they have been more democratic in language. They have given the chance to second language speakers to open up their schools, and knowing another language apart from English can be a credit to entrance to the university. But what lies, I think, at the bottom of all these things, if you want to take the language and tame it, you have to have an ethnic pride. And this is probably one of the key solutions. ethnic pride would be one of the chief factors in the maintenance of a national language.